Our next speaker is Mr. Jubair Sheikh. He is currently working as Global Account Manager at DHL Express India Private Limited and now handling FMCG and fashion vertical based out of Mumbai. He holds 8 years of experience with DHL Express. Prior to this, he has worked with Warburg International as an international business analyst holding 2 years of experience. Sir is a huge soccer fan and likes to play badminton. I request sir to kindly address the batch.
Good afternoon, everyone. I know it's Saturday, it's a little tough for you guys to sit and enjoy the discussions what we are having actually. Some of you would be now already in a mood of going to movies or you know, already planned for some kind of parties. So like Monica said, knowledge, a lot of things are happening. I think past 2 weeks, I think you have been going through a kind of induction, right?
Yes.
If I'm not wrong, okay. So thank you, ma'am, for the brief introduction. It feels good when I come back again. Last year also I had come back. Again this year also I had come back. I'm to give you a kind of introduction. I was from batch of 2002-2004. I did my MBA in sales and marketing. So like Monica said, HR is a heart. I believe sales is a blood of the organization. So I always have a lot of regard to the sales guys. So currently with DHL Express, I'm working as a global account manager and I manage a portfolio of FMCG sector in India and some fashion sector. So you can ask me questions, just be relaxed and ask me questions related to sales and marketing or can be related to finance as well. So I had a little bit of finance knowledge as well. So you can ask me the questions. It's been almost for me around 8 years of sales experience. So I feel that I may be wrong, but whatever I could gather from the experience, I can definitely share with you. Yes.
Hi, Ankit. One basic question I want to ask you that I have it's personal question. I am good at communication, sir, but it takes me time to gel up with people.
Okay.
So is it bad for me to go into sales? I want to opt for marketing.
But what is your inclination towards?
Sir, I want to go into advertising.
Advertising.
Yes.
So, why do you feel that advertising is good for you?
So, I am more of a creative person. I'm
okay.
A guitarist, musician, and I'm always inclined towards creativity.
Okay.
I try to do things in a different way, and I'm a big fan of do-it-yourself culture.
Okay.
So, I guess marketing, advertisement would be good for me.
So, do-it-yourself culture can work in finance also, can HR, in marketing, and sales, everywhere it can be a good thing to, you know, develop that skill. But if your inclination is toward advertising has a 3-4 sectors. There could be media planning, media buying, there's a script writers, okay, and there is also another division of event management, which I think, I forgot his name, the gentleman was discussing on that. So there are a lot of fields, so you need to know what are the different fields, what they are doing. So you need to do a kind of research behind with the team, with the media planning. Have you ever had a chance of discussing with companies like O&M?
From that background.
Okay.
Once we have
them,
I'll definitely ask.
I think best thing what you can do is that there are CII seminars which happens every year. Okay, so you can enroll yourself in that seminars and probably you'll come to know exactly what they are doing. So you can interact with the team. I have recently done kind of seminar a month back. So I've interacted with a couple of guys who have done campaign for BJP. So they have shared a lot of details, what they have done differently from what competition has done. So that was a good experience for me, even I was also not aware. I'm also not from that field, but I could able to know exactly what they are doing. So yes, if you want some more details, I have some data to give it to you. So maybe I can share with you offline. Thanks. Yes. Yes. See, I've not worked in the FMCG sector. I manage a channel of FMCG. So, attributes as in what you want to know. So, I am from DHL. I work towards developing a supply chain of a particular company. For example, HULs of the world, PNGs of the world. So what I do is that they have different sectors. So don't think that FMCG is only related to going to a supermarket or going to a retailer and speaking to them, developing your product portfolio, the SKUs. So don't think in that language. Think that what comes in and what goes out. So for example, L'Oreal wants to develop a shampoo. How they are going to develop a shampoo in the market? So it could be a different strategy for them. So that you have to learn. So you have to think in that angle. Don't think in the angle that, okay, if I'm going to work in sales or I'm going to work in HR, what would be my point of view? So you have to think in that angle that, you know, I'll start, for example, how the research starts in FMCG industry, okay? How the in-do-out as in what they get as a raw material, how they manufacture and how they distribute. So you need to know the entire supply chain. So it's not only that, you know, I do sales and marketing and my area of work is only limited to that aspect. So you have to think the 360 degree view. So that was the aspect. But you know, it looks little rosy in terms of knowing the FMCG, the big brands are there, but it's not that way it actually looks. You need to understand basically what value addition you are going to add. So that is what you have to develop. So maybe you require to know what companies are doing, what are their best practices, what they are implementing in Indian market, or what they are implemented in some other market of which they have implemented here. So that you want to learn. So based on that, then you gather your experience and then you decide. Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Mahir Agrawal. I'm from Rajasthan. Sir, can you please share your experience of last 8 years? What are the ups and downs you faced in their duration, and what you have learned from them?
It's kind of, I don't know where to start, but you know, I started my career with Warburg International. I joined as a management trainee. So that time I used to interact with a lot of teams. So it was 6 months kind of training program they used to have. So what they do, I'll interact with the finance team for some day, you know, 15 days I'll interact with them. I'll understand what they're doing. I'll interact with the investment banking team. Okay, I'll also interact with the teams which are into sales and marketing. So it's a kind of a different experience for me, but they absorbed me into a role of a business analyst. So I used to do a lot of business analysis. So I used to know the numbers like anything. So if you ask me that time, not right now, if you ask me what is the industry growth, if you ask me what is the manufacturing growth rate in India or somewhere in Africa, South Africa or somewhere in US, what is the industry, I could able to, you know, tell you exactly. What I had learned actually is that I used to interact with a lot of foreign vendors. So the vendor from Germany, vendor from US, Canada, so I used to interact with them a lot. So I actually gather a lot of information in terms of the industry perspective. So for example, if you tell me what is the packaging industry is doing in India, so I can able to tell you exactly what they are doing. If you tell me what kind of information technology is doing in India or in abroad, that I can able to tell you. So that was more of kind of, you know, a business analysis kind of experience. After that, I got an opportunity with DHL Express. So it's a completely different role. So my role was changed into completely into sales and completely to do with the sales. So I used to handle a set of customers, okay, handle a set of area. So I used to handle the Pune territory, and I was in charge of Pune territory. So I used to manage Pune territory, given it's a completely a sales-related job. I'd seen a lot of ups and downs in sales because I'm not from a sales background. I'm basically an engineer. So for me, it was a little difficult. I was not that well versed with the sales, how it works. I was always inclined towards finance, and I wanted to do always a finance course. But somewhere down the line, I feel that no, finance is not a sector for me. I think I should go to the sales. It's flamboyant job. You can learn a lot of things. You can meet people. You can build your network. And that's how I ended up into sales. So now, in terms of territory manager, I've handled a territory in Pune, then I handled a territory in Mumbai. Now I'm in Mumbai into a different role. I handle a set of customers, limited customers only I handle. So that comes from fashion and FMCG sector. So that's about the sales experience. So basically what I can suggest is that sales is not thing which you can learn, you know, sitting in a classroom. It's basically you need to adopt certain changes in your mind. You need to be positive every day. You need to be positive in terms of your attitude. Okay, you need to be positive So every time you need to be positive. So morning to evening you should be positive. Your energy should be, you are completely attached to your product, what you are selling. So that is what, or service what you are selling. So that is what you need to be sure that you are completely confident of what you are selling. So that's it all about sales. But one thing I can suggest is that you go with your mind, what your mind says. So that is the best thing which you can learn and you can implement.
After having this much experience, you ever thought about opening your own venture?
Yes, I get a lot of thoughts about opening my new venture. And I'm not able to get my investor. That's a problem. So it's not only about that, but what I feel that if you're working for an organization, you can get a lot of experience, you know, you gain your confidence back. And sometimes you feel that, yes, if I could able to develop my skills to a certain level, I can definitely start off with my own venture. But obviously you require a lot of things. You require a lot of investment, you require a lot of things which you need to do work at the back end. So that is one thing which you need to do a lot of research. So what industry you are going to be in, you need to know what they are doing. So the competition and a lot of things you would learn in your 2 years curriculum, what is BCG matrix and what are the value addition chains. So that you would learn. So you'll come to know that. But yes, definitely sometimes you get such kind of thoughts.
If you get an investor, then in which field do you want
to? If I get investor, I would definitely invest into e-com. Yes. I think we've done that, I think 2002 when we started off. I think Jay sir would be aware, we never thought that e-com would be such a big field. Maybe 10 years down the line, but now we've seen that, you know, we have learned that 10 years back, now we are implementing it here. So the people who have implemented now, maybe 5 years back, now they are earning a lot. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, sir.
My
question is, is it also the part of marketing or not?
Door-to-door marketing or door-to-door sales? There is a difference between sales and marketing. So what exactly you want to know? It is a door-to-door sales, right? So what do you want to know about door-to-door sales? I've not done door-to-door sales at all, but I can throw some light.
I want to ask you that so many people tell that door-to-door marketing, when we choose the marketing stream, so firstly we need to work at the door-to-door. We go to door-to-door, so
I think the best way to, it's the best way to start, because that's how you leave your all your attitude behind. I think that's the best way to start, but I won't recommend anybody to start that way. I always feel that, you know, you should start with a good kind of customer background, or you're meeting a good people in and around. But door-to-door marketing is definitely it's a hard-working job. You need to be a little bit smart worker in terms of how you meet people and how you analyze what they are thinking behind. So that you need to analyze, and it depends upon the what product you are selling. So it depends upon that. Hello.
I just wanted to ask that what is the scope of supply chain management and what kind of jobs are there in supply chain management?
Okay. I can tell you that supply chain is a big field. It's a vast field. So there are a lot of opportunities in supply chain. So supply chain in operations, supply chain in customer service, supply chain in sales and marketing, supply chain in production. So it could be a huge topic. So if I want to tell you supply chain in terms of an operation point of view, it could be related to how well you are addressing your customers. So how well you are giving your, for example, if I do a shipment for Unilever, okay, if they wanted a shipment within 2 days flat from US to India, so how they are going to do that? So what backend activities you are doing? Okay, so that you need to think. So that is a kind of operation related. Just I'm giving you, I'm not going into detail, but I'm giving you an overall picture. So that's how the operation thinks. In terms of sales and marketing, what they will think, what my competition is doing for them and what I'm doing. So what value added benefits I'm giving it to them. Okay, probably my services and their services are same, but what value addition I'm giving to them. So that is very much important. Of course, customers think that, you know, there is a brand attached to it, but yes, definitely the service does matter. In terms of customer service, what customer service I am giving? Okay, for example, in India, DHL offers 24/7 customer service, okay, which no other, not FedEx or UPS, they are not offering at all. So what value addition they are doing. So tomorrow if at 12 o'clock you get a call saying that where is my shipment, so you can direct them to customer service and they can easily able to handle the queries. So that's again related to customer service. Again, it comes to sales and marketing, which you know you cater to a lot of customers which are from different segments, which are from different backgrounds. So that's how you decide your way. So supply chain is a vast field. It's not limited to only an operation. So it's a vast field.
If I have an interest in supply chain management, what kind of sector I should pursue?
I think supply chain, if you want to really want to run supply chain, you should understand what is engineering and manufacturing industries are doing. So for example, you should know why Toyota is manufacturing vehicles. Okay, Toyota is currently at this point of time number one. Okay, as compared to GM. GM was 10 years back a number one company. But why? What Toyota is doing differently in terms of their operations, that they are able to, you know, manage the sales, they are able to keep the competition behind. So that you want to learn. So so it could be operations, it could be their production line, it could be their planning, what they are doing. So in that whole aspect you have to learn. So that's what I've told a little while back, that you need to know what companies are doing. So what they are getting in, how they are manufacturing, and how they are selling. So if you know this entire thing, then you are able to sell. So it could be with engineering manufacturing, you know how the system works, with FMCG, with IT sector. So you know the market, how it works. So you can implement it wherever you go. I hope I have answered your question. Good evening.
Hi, Keshav. I have two questions. First is, what is the work of portfolio manager? And second is, what is the work of CFA in any company? And if anyone want to what will become CFA? What is the article? Which type of article they should read?
I think CFA, CA and portfolio manager, I think more to do with the finance. So I may not be aware, I mean, I don't have that much experience to share with you, but what I can understand that portfolio manager and CFA, I think two are different, completely a different profile. So CFAs are completely different. I think that I have seen a lot of CFAs doing MBAs and then opting for CA and then becoming a CFA. But that is a completely altogether different sector altogether, which I may not be a right person to tell you.
What is the work of portfolio manager?
Portfolio manager is more to do with your investments. Okay, for example, HDFC has portfolio managers. So you and me, people like us, will go and invest into HDFC, one of the mutual funds, and it's job of portfolio managers to get that kind to invest that amount into a companies or into a bond or into a securities, and from that they'll get a kind of profit and they'll share with us. So it's job of portfolio manager to know exactly how the industry is working, and based on that what profit margin they can share with the customers. Hi. Yes. Yeah, tell me.
Good afternoon. My name is Vasant Patel. I am from Riva, Madhya Pradesh. If my question is that if as a fresher I entered into sales field and you have a target to achieve, so how do you feel and what is impact on your performance?
What does it take you to? Why do you think that sales is linked to target? No, it happens. It is linked to that. But why are you worried about target? That's what I'm asking. See, any sales sales driven organization, if you join, they would have definitely, they will give you a lot of trainings, first of all. Okay, they will give you a lot of understanding in terms of how the products are or what are the services they are going to sell. So that will automatically come. But you know, sometimes I feel that's my personal experience, that sales is something which you can learn while you are on their field. So that is what you can learn from the field itself. So it is not that, you know, you can definitely, classroom sessions can give you a lot of informations, but it's something which you can do practically on the field and then only you learn. So, you know, you'll fail one or two times, three times, four times, 10 times, 11 times, but doesn't matter. You have to always rise up and say that, you know, I'm fit for sale. So if you are sales, you should always say that I'm enthusiastic, I'm an energetic guy. Always say that, yes, I can do this. No matter what it comes, I can do this. So that is what you have to build the confidence, and don't think about target. Target will come automatically. You'll achieve your target once you have your confidence And once you have your, you know how to sell the product, it will automatically come. So don't worry about the targets. It will come. Those are the things which always link to your sales targets and budgets. But definitely, it's a part of your job to sell if you are into sales. So don't think that, you know, sales is always, you know, you need to sell, go and sell in the market. Don't think in that way. You know, in companies where large multinational companies, they think that it's not only about the sales. They also think about the person who is actually working, or whether it is a hardworking person, or if it is, what kind of attitude is carrying. So even if you are not achieving your targets, still they think that, you know, this person is a is an asset for our company, and definitely he can grow in probably, you know, 2 years down the line or 3 years down the line. So definitely, so it's not, so don't worry about the target. So it will come automatically. If you have a confidence, it will come automatically.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sukhat. Basically, I want to know that, it's a personal question, that
I'm from engineering background. I have around about 1 year of experience with tower manufacturing company, that is KEC International.
KEC International.
KEC International, Limited in Butibori.
Nagpur.
So I was there, worked as a planning engineer. And after that, I worked in web development company. So I've opted for MBA. I just wanted to know that which field I need to select after having such kind of experience. But related to my engineering field only.
Related to your engineering field?
Yeah.
Why you want to limit your options to engineering field only?
I think that I want to apply my technical skills again, because I was most, I was mostly inclined to it.
Okay. So why don't you opt for you know, kind of operations as in you should know if you are inclined towards engineering, okay, you should look at the option of, if I do 2 years of MBA, okay, what valuation I'm going to add in an engineering and manufacturing field. So it could be related to your technical sales, okay, it could be related to your technical sales. A lot of software companies now, they're recruiting MBAs who have engineering background, but they also should know how to sell in the market, okay. So you can look out for companies like small companies. I'm not giving you a big company like Infosys or TCS. Small companies or startup companies, where, you know, they would recruit a lot of engineers who have an MBA kind of background. So that would give a management background plus a technical background. So that combination works for them. So for you, it would be easier to get into that field, an IT or engineering and manufacturing field, rather than going into a field of finance. That's what my personal experience. Maybe, you know, 2 years down the line, you would change your decision also. So, because the way I changed my decision, 2 years down the line, you would also change your decision. So it depends, but specifically on you, where your inclinations are. Because I think these 2 years are very important for you. So you don't limit yourself to a particular field. Try to explore your options. You know, there are a lot of fields within India, so you can try to explore your options to even HR also, or even finance also. So don't limit yourself.
But which sector has most, I think, a wide scope in that regarding is that companies of manufacturing or IT companies?
So manufacturing always has a lot of opportunities. So, you know, there are a lot of ups and downs in manufacturing industries. But what I would suggest is that at this point of time, services industry or IT industry if I compare IT and services, I think services industry is far more better. So I think that's the best thing for you if you opt yourself for services, but ultimately it depends upon your interests.
Sir, as you told that you work with Achievel and PNG and all, sir, Achievel made the best survey of rural market.
Right.
In the rural areas. Sir, as in the present era, rural areas are being developed into urban areas.
Mm-hmm.
And in coming future of 40 to 50 years, there will be very less rural area in India.
Right.
So sir, what's the scope in rural marketing if we opt for it? And how would the companies are going to leave the rural market and come up to urban market, as today they are approaching more over for the rural market?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you want to ask basically 10 years down the line, what would be for HULs of the world or PNGs of the world? That's what you want to ask. Right. So basically, at this point of time, India is still, you know, the big companies are still think that, you know, they have still not approached rural market in that way. So I have recently attended one seminar. So a lot of scope for them in rural market. So even if they think that, you know, 5 years down the line, even if they grow within rural market, they still have a lot of chance in rural market. So it's not they're not limiting themselves to a particular sector. They're going it across the India. So maybe 10 years down the line, you would see that a rural market is developed. But there are a lot of opportunities in rural market. I mean, I personally interacted with one of the VPs of the Pepsi and Rasna, for example. They said that they always said that rural market is the future for us, because they have already saturated in the metros and mini metros. They always feel that rural market is the best way to enter into a particular segment and start their own venture. So if they want to launch a new product, if they want to launch which is not a premium product but a kind of low level middle kind of level product, they always think that rural market is the best way to do it. So I'm not sure 10 years down the line how big it would be, but they feel that, you know, 5 years down the line, yes, definitely rural market would be a kind of a game changer for them.
And one more thing, related to the advertising sector. So like Amul set up a single advertisement of a girl over there in 1930,
right,
when they came up with the idea. And sir, from that time, my initiative has been moved, which is written in the Guinness Book of World Records. That initiative is still moving on.
Right.
That they take the presentation and present it as an
advertisement. Right.
So sir, being an industry, being a company, shall we stop with a single idea or we should come with better ideas and innovations further?
See, innovations, you mean to say in advertising?
Yes.
So you mean to say the logo, they kept it same?
Yes, sir. The Amul logo is already always the same from 1930 till now.
Yes, yes. See, it depends basically upon 3-4 factors are there. You will learn into your advertising sessions probably. So the 3-4 sectors basically, what happens is that in which market you are, first of all, the most important thing is in which market you are. Secondly, what product you are selling. Okay, third thing, what kind of consumers you're off, what kind of product additions you are doing. For example, if Amul wants to sell a cheese or a butter in a different market, what kind of attachment to it? For example, tomorrow if Reliance is going to sell a milk, nobody is going to buy, because I'm not sure what Reliance is going to, you know. I know that Reliance is into textile, into energy, into different industrial segments. But tomorrow if Reliance says I'm into a milk segment, so I would definitely go for Amul, not going for Reliance, right? So it's the same way. They have kept it same way. I don't know exactly what is the strategy, but the reason behind is that could be that, you know, they want to stick to the same logo just to keep consumers aware that, you know, this is Amul logo and I want to buy Amul you know, butter or whatever maybe the product. What happens is that in rural market, okay, people cannot able to read sometimes. Okay, it's not the fact right now, but people, there are still some markets where people, they are not able to read. So they generally what do, they see the logo, and they see the logo and they pick up the product. So for them it works. Sometimes for them it works in rural market. Probably that might be the reason they are keeping the same kind of logo. I can give you one more example of my own company. We've took over Blue Dart Express 5 years back. Okay, but the brand image was so good for Blue Dart in India that we don't want to change their name to DHL. So that was one of the reason we kept the same brand name. From last, I think 7-8 years, we've kept the same brand name, but we are not changing the brand name because the brand name is very strong. It's a premium product in the market, but we are not changing the brand at all. It's the same brand name we are keeping. We are sticking to the same brand. We're not giving the DHL branding to them.
So,
yeah, yeah.
So, like, in a Economic Times or somewhere, I read that 30% of the total income what corporate gets is wasted out in the rural cases. The government and the corporate are taking the measures to stop.
That's something even I used to think earlier, but even I'm not sure what they are going to do with that. I think Maharashtra, probably Bombay, contributes around 30% of the tax of the entire India, if I'm not wrong. 25 or 30% of the entire tax of India, if I'm not wrong. But the developments are, if I see, it's very minimum. So, but I don't know exactly what is the motivation behind of asking this question.
Sir, like, I read it somewhere that 30% of total income what India corporate gains,
okay,
is wasted out in duplicates. Like Pepsi ka duplicate and everything ka duplication mobile is the most today. So sir, what initiatives can be taken to stop that duplicacy at a limit so that the profit can be maximized?
Duplication as in you mean to say the copy products?
Yes sir. No sir, like Pepsi, sir, there is a blue tag on Pepsi.
Right.
There comes a red tag.
Right.
And we are confused in that, and moreover the 30% of the sales is affected due to that.
Right. Okay, so you want to know what government can do to avoid I think FDA and FSSI, other organizations, you know, they are already there in the market. So it's basically, it's their job to, you know, promote the products which are licensed and which are non-licensed or which are getting sold in unorganized market, which I think they are the people who are actually stopping it. So I think it's more to do with the compliance kind of thing, which I think FDA and FSSI, they're already doing it. I think it's more to do with once the market gets established in India, I think you will see that there are only two brands, Pepsi and Coke, you know, if there are no other brands coming into in an organized market. I think it's more to do with the time. It comes with the time only. Thank you. Finance, I think the gentleman said already, you have the portfolio manager, you have there are a lot of companies that are actually taking CAs for tax calculations and the tax managers. Okay, apart from that, you could also look out for the option of investment banking. People say that it's a most coveted job across industries. So I've personally seen that my friends in different segments, they've worked in investment banking, and the salaries what they are getting are exceptionally higher than what, you know, the market trends are. But don't go with the salaries. Make sure that you learn a lot, okay? Because I worked with investment banking for 1.5 years. So you make sure that you learn a lot, and once you gain a knowledge, then you move into that segment. So you need to know how industry is working. So tomorrow, if someone asks you, tomorrow if investment banking firm comes here in IBM for a recruitment, you know, you should know how industry is working. So you should know back of your mind that what questions are they going to ask. So you should know the industry, how it's working, what is the growth rate, what is the inflation doing, what do you think that you can add to that company, a value addition probably. So you have to think in that level. So I think investment banking is the best way to start your career. It's a little difficult but at this point of time, but that's the best way to start your work. Yes, there is scope for finance. It's coming up right now. Finance is again, this industry is coming up, but people are more opting towards, for example, if a BCom graduate is opting for MBA because they feel that if I do MBA, I can grow faster. So that is again a kind of, they get an elevation in terms of their current hierarchy. So, and apart from that, I think CA also helps a lot. So I think these two things would definitely help. Yes, sir. Good evening. Hi. Yes.
Sir, as you have a lot of experience in the global market, sir, if a person wants to launch his product globally, what is the first step he should take and what are the resources and market strategy needed?
See, it's a big question actually. It's a good question, but it's a it's kind of question wherein you should know exactly in which market you are going. So you need to know what countries are doing. So you need to know what are their rules and regulations. For example, if I want to launch a shampoo in Dubai, okay, you need to know what are their laws of the land. So you should know what are the laws of the land, and you should comply to the laws of that particular land. So, and then you need to know if you can invest completely in that country. So you could require an investor which is originator from that country, and there could be a share of around 49-50 depending upon that country's regulation. Then you start investing, and then but before that you need to know, you should have done your market research. So you should know what is the market I'm catering to, okay? Yeah, so market is very important. So market which you are catering to, and what kind of research you have done to make sure that, you know, you'll get this much amount of sales. So you should have a backup plan. So tomorrow if I say that my product, you know, if I'm not able to sell my product in the market, you need to have a backup plan. So what backup plan you have? So you need to always have a plan A and plan B in place. So if plan A does not work, what is the plan B for you? So you need to have that kind of things. You should always think. I think best way is to do it that I've seen people, they work for a company for, let's say, around 5-6 years, and then they start their venture. So it depends upon your confidence level and the way you have done your market research. And that's the best way to do it. Yes. Yes.
Sir, as you tell us, you are interested in e-commerce. What was the opportunities in e-commerce and what was the disadvantage of e-commerce?
As of now, I mean, I have seen there is no disadvantage in the current industry, what it is going through.
What are the career opportunities and what are the benefits which is easily to hit?
I think I can tell you that from the supply chain point of view, that I am getting a lot of calls from the e-com retailers at this point of time. Basically, they want to do a kind of integration of their operations. A lot of companies, what they are doing, like Flipkart, they've started with their own operations and own setup. But some point of time, they felt that, you know, we have to work like a eBay and Amazon, how they are working. So they are not doing anything. They are not storing their own products. They are outsourcing it for someone else. The seller is actually different. So it's just a portal which are implementing it. Whatever products they have, they are posting it onto that internet. And based on that, the end consumer is actually getting the product. So the actual revenue blockage, what they have, it's limited. So they're not blocking their revenue, but they're blocking someone else's revenue, but they're getting the major benefit out of it. So as of now, what I've seen is that it's not related to sales and marketing or HR. What I feel that operation is the most important thing for them at this point of time.
So which is of the homework to do first to
business in e-com? For what?
For establish a business in
e-commerce. I think we have e-commerce as a subject, right, sir? I think that subject will give you the entire in-depth knowledge. But I would suggest the important thing is that you should do all your research. First, you should know what they are doing. You should know what Flipkart is doing and what it is doing different from eBay. You should know what are the power sellers. There are some power sellers which, you know, sell on eBay sites, and if they get consumer feedback, if they get 5-star, then they become a power seller. If they get a bad feedback from a consumer, that goes to eBay site saying that, you know, this is a seller which is not good, you can remove the seller. So eBay has that kind of guarantee that they give to the consumers. So I think that is one. And I think more to do with you should study the case studies. The best way to learn e-com is study the case study. Take one of the case studies from internet. There are a lot of things available at this point of time. You should take one of the case study from internet. Let's say, for example, Amazon, you'll get a lot of information on Amazon, okay? You'll get a lot of information on eBay, okay? You should also learn what are the sites. There are a lot of sites which have started, but they're not able to, they're not able to get into the market properly, and they go into the liquidation. So you should know what they have learned and what they have implemented in the market. So I think start with a case study. I think it's a good example for you. If you can learn within 3 months what is the e-com, and you can present in front of the audience, and that's the best way to do it. So any more questions? Okay then. Thank you so much. Thank you so much and all the best.